Working with Karl is not something I ever thought about would happen. Although I will tell you, I was a massive fan of the podcasts. Even before the podcasts, XFM, you know, so I kind of was one of the early adopters of Karl and Ricky and Stephen in that sense. And then obviously when they started doing the podcast, couldn't get enough of those. And then once I got to know Ricky, I said, you know, I really want to meet Karl. And he said, oh, I'll see if, what's that? Yeah, well, I'll just finish the so I said, I really want to meet Karl. And then Ricky would say this to Karl, and Karl can't be bothered to do anything. So he never bothered to visit the set or anything when we were doing extras. And then Ricky had this idea that we should meet, but if we do, it should be on camera. So we did a DVD extra for his science DVD of his stand-up show. And that is our first encounter. And it was funny, you know, we arrived at the recording studio and Ricky said, you mustn't meet before. I want it to happen on camera, you know. And it was great because I was just a big fan. So I was kind of giving Karl quite a lot of respect, as you would anybody else. But Karl was giving me none back, which was kind of fun. And then out of that, really, I mean, we kind of got to know each other a bit. And then when we were doing Life's Too Short, I happened to hear Ricky talking to Karl on the phone. He said, he's moaning again. You know, I want him to go away, and he's going off to do the second series of Idiot Abroad, and he was moaning about it. I said, he's really lucky to be able to do that and travel the world and get paid at the same time. And that started Ricky thinking, you know, and at the same time, Karl was saying, I'm not going to do another one unless you come with me, Ricky. And then Ricky doesn't really like leaving Hampstead particularly, so he kind of put the two of us together, and that's what became Idiot Abroad 3.
I mean, obviously, during the course of that series, there seemed like there were some genuine moments of tension between the two of you. Can you talk a little bit about that? Because I think the tone seemed to vary quite dramatically.
Yeah, well, I mean, Karl is always very particular about, you know, what he does, and the way Idiot Abroad works is that it has to be real. You know, there's no faking it. It's got to be the real sense of emotion or humor or whatever's happening in the situation has to play out naturally, and the cameras have to be ready to follow that. So when we were doing Idiot Abroad 3, we each had a camera crew with us, me and Karl. So if one of us decided to leave a situation, it could be captured. You know, there was never anything, you never felt like you were restricted. If you didn't like what you were doing, you didn't do it and you went and did something else or what have you. So everything is played out exactly as it happens. And we know very little about it as well, you know, going, we'll arrive somewhere and then we'll be told you're going to meet such and such. And then it's us to go in and find out what this guy's all about or what this situation is. And there were times when we would very much dictate what happened or where we went. You know, we were travelling on a train in India and it was madness. You know, I had a better ticket than Karl, but he was so annoyed about that. When the train pulled up somewhere, he got off and started running along the side of the train, and then it started to leave again and he almost didn't get back on it. I mean, all of these things just play out. And I mean, much of that series is almost missing in a way because the camera should be rolling the entire time, because even when we're on a flight together or, you know, going through customs, Karl is still making his comments, his remarks. It's not for the cameras. It's happening all the time. And it makes me laugh a lot. It does your head in, but it makes you laugh too.
Is Karl asking you whether or not you have knees the stupidest thing he said to you?
Well, yeah, he did. That was, we were sat at the top of the Macau Tower in Macau, 750 feet off the ground. My legs were hanging over the edge. And because they were sticking out straight over the edge like that, and they weren't sort of bent like that, it came to his mind, you know, wondering whether I in fact did have knees or not, which is a very typical Karl thing to say, but it's one of those things that everybody remembers about what he said to me. I do have knees, just for the record now, and they bend very nicely, but often when I'm sitting on a chair, that's what ends up happening. And it just, I mean, that is a definite Karl classic.
Anything you said off camera that's on that level, though?
Oh, God. I mean, so many things. Just so, I mean, I can't, I mean, I did start to write a diary because I thought it was really fun, but I got too exhausted, honestly. The days are so long, I couldn't even write in the end, so I didn't do it. But we stayed in some interesting places. I once stayed in a hotel, and There were lizards literally running around all around the room. I sort of laid in bed like this, and the walls were like alive with things running around. And the air conditioner was broken, and it didn't make cold air. All it did was make water. I woke up, and there was like that much water in the room, all over everything, my suitcase. I mean, just the things that we put up with for your entertainment, honestly. It's unbelievable. One of the funniest things for me, though, was we... I mean, it's quite a very serene place on the Ganges in Varanasi, I think it is, where they actually cremate the bodies on the shores. And me and Carl went out on a boat very early in the morning to watch the sunrise over the Ganges. It's something very, very kind of poignant that we wanted to do. And then meanwhile, while we're on this boat, then there's some ash was falling down, you know, as it does from these fires. And a bit landed on Carl, and I looked down and thought, how unlucky is that poor person there who's just been cremated? They wanted to land in the kind of sacred Ganges River, and they've landed on Carl's leg. You know, they've travelled all this way across India to get here to have this moment, and now that's what happened. You know, I just, yeah, it brought it all home to me.